So my name is Jérôme Louvel. I'm the CEO of Reslet. Reslet is a web API platform vendor. Main product is called API Spark. It's an all-in-one platform as a service that lets you build, host, and manage your web APIs from a simple web browser. The talk today I will present is about web APIs and trying to think about web APIs as a new language frontier. So what does that mean? If we look quickly at the evolution of programming languages, this is a list of the top 20 programming languages in the world. The source is the Tobi index. If we look at this list, we can see that C language is still in the first position, and the assembly language is still in the 20 position. So we have a lot of stability across the years. We still have COBOL, PL, SQL as top language, top programming languages. So really, programming languages are a tale of abstraction. We start from the hardware. We have assembly languages, so it's the lowest level of programming languages. It's very tedious to write and to maintain. So we had to build and to provide system languages on top of that, and C is the most important system language so far. So it's great for native development, for operating system, and this kind of application. So very high performance, close to the kernel. On top of that, most of the development today is made through application, what we call application languages. So it's about Java, JavaScript, PHP, Ruby, and so on. So this type of languages, what they bring is a better productivity, better portability. It's perfect for business logic, business rules, and UI developments. Our vision is that on top of this application languages layer, we are seeing and we will see a new layer of web API languages, or even in a more general sense, web languages that we provide in addition to application languages, web scale, high availability, multi-tenancy, and just a way of programming through web APIs. So you can see a couple of examples of those languages. Let's look closer now at these web API languages. So the current state, it's mostly about, so you see some examples about Swagger, RAML, and Google API Discovery, API Blueprint, and there are a couple of other ones like Waddle and so on. So today, these web API languages, what they focus is on describing the web APIs, the contract in some way of this API. So it's mostly APIs that are XML, JSON-driven in terms of representation. And they will help to declare properly the HTTP methods, the URIs, and the way you can interact with the web API. Typically, those languages, they use markup. They are markup languages. They are built on top of XML, JSON, YAML, and Markdown. So it's pretty different from the typical programming languages that I mentioned before, that have their own syntax in some way. So these web API languages, what they bring is the ability to generate some source code for the client SDK, for the server skeleton, and so on. So it's really great. It's helping for documentation as well. What could be the next stage in terms of web API languages? Our vision is that we really need to go further and not only describe the web API, but really help program the web through web APIs. So instead of invoking like a Java API to do your input, output, and to get some additional functionality, the idea would be to program through web APIs, which could be either local or remote web APIs, and just natively speaking the HTTP semantics. Calling HTTP methods should be just like part of the syntax of the language. You shouldn't have to go through a web API framework or HTTP library to do that. So it's not only about the API contract, it's about the implementation of this API. So web APIs could be local or remote. What that brings is that you have an inherent component-based approach. So it's very flexible to say, I can start with a local web API for this extra function of my my application, my backend. And then at a later stage, I can move this component to another machine to another site, so without breaking the original application and implementation. So it should be ready for load balancing, scaling, cross-region, should be really designed for the cloud. So multi-tenancy is really key for web APIs. Running on top of infrastructure as a service should be really something that is thought and part of the programming language. So today, when you write a Java application, it's you are targeting a single Java virtual machine. You don't really think about the final deployment on the cloud and all the scaling. And still, it's really important. In Java, you have all the sandboxing, security aspect, but it was not really designed for cloud era. So we can really do better if we bring those constraints right inside the programming language. Having the persistent service built into the language is really something key in our mind, because web APIs are really linked to the data and the lifecycle is very close. So you have a couple of examples. WebShell is a great example of a web API language that is JavaScript based. In API Spark, we have our own internal domain specific language that we build with this kind of ideas in mind. And there is a pioneering language that is called HOPE that was developed by the INRIA researcher, which is a great example as well in terms of what we could do on this front. So if we consider this next stage and next evolution of web API language, that brings us to really fully rethink the web API development process. So let's try to make some parallel with a typical development aspect. So when you write code, typically you need an editor to write your source code. So if you think about an API editor, it should be either a visual editor, a command line editor. It should really let the developer code at the API level directly in a very collaborative mode. So you can think about Google Docs or GitHub style. It should be something really easy to do. Easy to compose multiple APIs, so you should be able to import right into your language some third-party APIs, get directly the contract of this API, get some code completion, and being able to invoke this API without having to bring some client SDK or to import some third-party libraries and so on, or to manage all these dependencies. So you have many efforts that are currently made on this front by several companies that I mentioned at the bottom of this slide. The next aspect is about compilation. It's really something that is core for each programming language. So compilers is really a way to translate a higher level language into a lower level language. So like the C language is going to be translated to assembly language, Java language will generate some bytecode that is using that is executed on top of C language, which is part of the Java virtual machine. So a web API language should probably translate this code into an application language code, like a Java. So in API Spark, it's really what we do. When you compile your API in API Spark, we generate some Java source code that is then compiled as a Java language and then deployed. Debugging is also something that can be fully rethought in terms of API. So today it's very natural as a Java developer, as a PHP developer, and so on to debug your application. So you can put some breakpoints, you can pause your application, look at the threads, and so on, explore the variables. Really, you should be able to do the same thing with web API. You should be able to say, okay, I get this call, this incoming API call, I should be able to really track it. Pause it, look at all the context, and then continue the execution, put some breakpoints, and so on. So really having an interactive live debugger is something that is really key. Today, there are really little examples of that in the API front. The RunScope company, startup, is moving in this direction. It's really interesting, and obviously, there is a lot of room for innovation. But in terms of productivity, development productivity is going to be really key to have this kind of live debugger. Next state is about API running. So when you write your Java code, it's very easy to run your application, to test it. And so it should be really as easy to test your API. And again, it's not only the contract, it's about the full implementation of your API. So today, when you want to do that, you need to use a web API framework, and then you run your full stack. Running an API is very similar in some way to the API deployment. Deployment is about deploying in production or in staging your API and make sure that third-party user partners can access your API. But before being able to do that, you should be able, as a developer, to test locally in some way your API. So running is mostly about being able to deploy in your own development environment and being able to do some tests without impacting third-party users or developers. So really the special features that we can sync with a proper Web API language and Web API execution platform is about removing the separation between the Web API framework and the actual language for, again, better productivity. And again, a lot of room for innovation. We have some features on this front in API Spark, Web Shell as well as some features that are based on Node.js. API documentation is a more mature front because it's closer to the API contract, so a lot of effort have been made on this front. Probably we can go even further. I won't expand too much on this part. Something that can be interesting to do is not only document the contract, but the implementation as well of your API. When you write an application, typical application, you not only want to describe the, for example, the Java API, what is made, the input, the output, but also all the details of your implementation, what really happens when this API is invoked, to share this knowledge with other developers. So I think as API grow and get more complex, and as team of API developers work on the same API, you not only need to think about the public API and just the end user of your API and being able to document, you know, for these guys, you also need to be able to document for your internal team to share all this implementation details is really key. So I guess in the future, we'll need to separate the internal API documentation, like a Java documentation, like a Java doc for APIs, from the end user API. The user guide, the tutorial is going to be managed separately. Part of it can be automated, or the structure can be automated, but all the documentation has to be probably done by a technical writer, somebody who's not the actual developer of your API. The next step in an API development project is about the deployment, actual deployment of your web API. I've talked about that a little before when talking about the API, you know, running aspect. Deploying an API, if we make a parallel again with the current development practices, like a Java developer, we'll typically use Eclipse IDE to deploy his web application packages as a WAR file. Can make the parallel with other programming languages. So you will be able to target some remote application server that will host your WAR file, your application. So deploying an API should be as simple and as integrated in terms of the API IDE. So it's just about pressing a button, should be able to target either the staging, the production environment, to manage all the versioning, the lifecycle of your API. Some things that should be really given for and very productive. Currently, it's a lot of, you need to think about a lot of things and manage multiple PCs, the API managers, your infrastructure as a service, or maybe your generic platform as a service, like Google App Engine and so on. So, a lot of moving pieces, it's really hard to be very productive and we can do much better. So API development should really be built for the cloud on top of infrastructure as a service. It should have cross-region deployment really in mind. It's a key option for us. An API should be highly available, has a low latency, either if you access it from Europe, from the US. It's like a website, they need to be really fast. And we need to provide some content delivery network kind of feature for web API as well for dynamic data. So a lot of front for innovation. Again, a couple of companies that are providing this deployment, you know, API deployment as a service kind of feature, /DB, API Spark, Socrata, API Foundry as well. It's very easy, very quick to deploy your API without having to take care of the full stack. So let me do a quick illustration with API Spark, our platform as a service. So hopefully the Wi-Fi will be fast enough. So with API Spark, you can log in very quickly using your GitHub account or your Google account. So I will use my Gmail account. So once your log, you reach your dashboard in API Spark, from this dashboard, you can quickly create a data store. So it's a database that can host your structured data, the data that you want to expose to one or multiple web APIs. Let's call it a demo store. So this entity store can be either local to API Spark, so hosted fully on API Spark. It can pull some data from a third party data source, like a JDBC database, like a backend as a service. Like we support StackMob, Parse.com, Firebase. You can even pull your data from a Google spreadsheet. So it's really great for open data project when you want to expose this open data as a programmable web API. So let's create a very quick entity store. Okay, so let me add a first entity for, let's say it's for this conference. I want an entity for a talk. I will add a couple of properties. I've got the title of my talk. And the speaker. Let me add a second one. Let's say we want to manage a list of our sponsors for the conference. So I'm starting from scratch. Obviously, it's quicker when you export an existing schema from an existing database. But okay, so you got the idea. We've got two entities. Now we can deploy this entity store. So this database will be available right now in production. So let's wait a couple of seconds. So the database is, technically speaking, is hosted on a Cassandra ring. So it's a highly available database. So when you make some modification to your schema, you don't have to stop your database, stop all your web APIs to be able to do the schema evolution and then, you know, launch it again. Everything could be made as a live upgrade. So next step is about exporting a web API for this data store. So let's say we want to call it demo2 web API. So the subdomain name is available. So by default, we provide a subdomain of apispark.net. You can attach your own custom domain for your API. And we can create this API. So it's going to generate for each entity a couple of resources in your API. Okay, so we now have our API. So it has this endpoint where you can access, get all the credential aspect. We've got four resource classes, two for each entity, one for the collection of talks, one for each individual talk, and the same for sponsors. And so you can see the, you know, usual HTTP method. We also expose, in terms of API contracts, a list of representation. So a talk can be retrieved as a JSON, YAML, XML, and potentially other formats. So it can even support CSV and so on. HTML is supported as well. So we've got our API, and we can now deploy this API. So when you click this button, we really compile the API. So what I mentioned before is we translate internal domain-specific language for web APIs as the Java source code. This source code is compiled, packaged, and shipped into production, and the API is available right now to make some calls. So I can quickly do a test using the browser, so I can retrieve the list of talks. So let's get my credentials. Password. So we also support HTTPS. We plan to add support for OAuth as well. Okay, so it's invoking. So I got the list of talk. Obviously, right now we don't have any data in the database, but we were able to retrieve the list as XML. I can get for using content negotiation the JSON version of that. So I was able to make a couple of calls. I could start to put some data in my API very easily as well. I can download some SDK for Java, JavaScript, iOS, and so on. I can even go to my analytics dashboard, and I can see the number of calls that were made, the location of this call, so I was able to make some call from France, and the response status. So we got a 401 error for the authentication, the login password, the dialogue, and then I was able to make two successful calls to my web API. So built-in API management feature, I can manage the list of members of my API and so on. Versioning is taken is part of API Spark, so right now I'm working on version 1 of my API, which is in a draft state, so I can't expose it to an API user. I need first to publish it. So all the lifecycle of the API is fully managed. So you can really think about this web application, web console, as an IDE for web APIs. So let me come back to my presentation and reach the conclusion. So really our vision is that infrastructure as a service is a true revolution in terms of cloud computing. It fully embraces web APIs. So when you invoke Amazon S3, EC2, everything that you can do with this infrastructure is done through web APIs. If you think about platform as a service, it's not really a revolution yet. Doesn't have a lot of adoption, a lot of traction. It's just, right now, it's just an evolution. Of course, it's much easier to do some deployment, but it just simplifies the deployment aspect of a project. It doesn't really change anything in terms of the actual creation, development of your application or of your web API. So it's same application languages, Java, Ruby, and so on, same complexity, time, and cost to really ship a project in production. So there is really, in our mind, a lot of room for improvement, and it's really, for us, it's time for a new evolution of platform as a service, something that really go much further and try to take care of the full life cycle of a project, of a web API project. So really fully embracing web API as a disruption factor is really key for us. Cross-region deployment, zero downtime, low latency should really become standard. And part of the service level agreements. And why do you need that? It's because as soon as you expose an API and you have some partners, some users, customer relying on your API, as soon as you stop it, even for maintenance, you stop all your partners. You stop their application, you stop their mashups, and so on. It's really something that is really hard to accept. So it's raising the bar, and it's very difficult to manage that. So we work on that in API Spark, we provide that, and it's a lot of work. It's very complex to manage this kind of high availability. So a platform is really a good way to provide this feature to SaaS application developers, to mobile application developers, and so on. And at the same time, we should really try to reduce the cost and time to market for application and for web APIs. And if we have all these ingredients, we can really have a revolution for platform as a service in the same way that infrastructure as a service is a revolution. So it's a whole new game, and it's really exciting to be in this stage of the cloud computing industry. And some breaking news for Reset, our company. So we recently raised a seed round from some French venture capitalists. So we raised $2 million to expand our engineering team in France and to accelerate the marketing efforts in the US. So we are really happy to have some very experienced board member that joined our company board, such as Bertrand Diaz, who's the co-founder of Talent, Mathieu Hugues, the CEO of Run My Process, Workflow as a Service, really a pioneer platform as a service as well. He's based in Paris, Reza Malekzadeh, who is VP Business of Cumulus. He worked for VMware in the past, and he's based in Los Altos as well. We have a third co-founder who joined us as well. He's Steve Schwartz, he's a VP of Engineering, and he will be talking tomorrow about web API creation. And today we are really happy to announce the API public beta. So we remove all the restrictions, so there is no more waiting list, so you can directly connect to API Spark, create your account, and deploy your first API. And please send us some feedback. We really want to improve API Spark and before we reach version 1 in the commercial version. So it's a good stage to send us your feedback so we can improve and make it a better platform. So thank you very much for your attention. If you have any questions.
Any question? We have time for one or two.
So the way we address that in API Spark is what I show is a console, so it's like an IDE, but this web page can be accessed by the end user of the API. Of course, this user won't be able to modify the API, but we are able to manage multiple roles in API Spark. So you can either be a developer, even a manager, so you can't really modify the API, but you can have access to the analytics, you can add some members and so on. And you can be an end user. And when you are an end user, you see this page as an interactive API documentation. And we are working towards the ability to test directly from this page, you know, to do some calls directly from this page. So you have like the full interactive API documentation, like you have in Swagger and so on. So that's a way for us to address. It's really like a two-sided platform that we are developing. So actually, you have two options. Either you can host the data on API Spark on our platform. So it's based on Cassandra, which is highly available in a NoSQL database. Everything is hosted on top of Amazon Web Services currently in terms of scalability and so on. But we also have the option to import some data from third-party sources. So you can import it from an existing relational database, from a backend of service, from a Google spreadsheet, and we plan to add more sources of data, like pulling the data from a force.com, Salesforce backend, and so on. We plan to expand that. Yeah, the issue when you get some third-party data is you get some extra latency, and you are, in terms of high availability of free API, it's harder to ensure the high availability of the and API, so you need to be careful about that. And we're working on some, you know, evolution of this feature to be able to synchronize in some way this third-party, you know, data with like a local copy in API Spark, so we can really fully manage this high availability. So it's not available right now, but it's something we are planning to add. Any other question?
So you said that the platform as a service market isn't really as robust and as vibrant as obviously as infrastructure as a service. How does that then apply to what you guys are doing? And can you provide perspective, you know, on the contrast there?
Really for us is what we try to do with API Spark is not only provide a solution for easy API deployment hosting, which is something you can already do with Google App Engine, Heroku, and so on. So it does save some time, but we really want to make sure the platform is taking care of the full life cycle of the API project. So really the creation, the coding of your API, the testing, local testing, all the life cycle of an API, how do you manage the version of your API, or do you manage multiple versions in parallel? Or do you make sure that the cost of hosting an API is really low? It's as cheap as hosting a blog in some way on WordPress. WordPress is really a platform. It's a full platform for, you know, web publishing. It's very efficient, very low cost, very fast time to market. You can get your blog in a couple of minutes, seconds. Just using typical, you know, platforms of service, and again, I mentioned a couple of names, AWS, Beanstalk, is just solving the end, you know, part. Once you have developed your web API project, a couple of weeks, months, you are able to really click on the button and ship it in production. We should really try to embrace a full life cycle, and if we do that, I guess we can, you know, create much more, you know, APIs. And if we want to really build like millions of APIs in the coming years, we need to be as productive as WordPress or Tumblr, you know, for blogs. So that's really the idea of something much more, you know, efficient. What?
The current platform is a service provider.
No. You still need to write your Java code, your Ruby code, and so on. And you need to test it. It's a lot of work to get this first part done. Then you need to deploy it, and probably you need to add some API manager, you know, on top of that, and manage all these moving pieces. And so I think we need to have like some verticalized platform as a service. WordPress is one example for web publishing. We should have some verticalized platform as a service for web APIs. And probably for other markets, other industries, we will see some, you know, much more specialized paths as well. That's the idea.